Health officials are taking no chances as they race to contain an outbreak of one of the world's deadliest viruses, Ebola. There's no cure or vaccine, and for the first time ever on this scale, Ebola has broken out in an urban area. Ebola is not easy to catch, transmitted only from direct contact with blood or saliva, but it's highly lethal. The World Health Organization is very concerned.
The largest Ebola outbreak in history began in West Africa in 2014. Tens of thousands of people were infected. More than 11,000 people died. And part of what made Ebola so scary at the time, and part of what still makes it so terrifying, is the catastrophic mortality rate associated with the disease. About 50% of the people who get Ebola die. And back in 2014, one of the other things that made Ebola so scary was that there was no vaccine to protect people from getting it. But in the years since, that has changed. Two vaccines have actually been approved. And one of those vaccines, produced by Johnson & Johnson, which becomes strangely relevant in a minute, does something really interesting. It's called a mix-and-match vaccine. It's because it uses different shots as a way to elicit a more powerful immune response. Now, that strategy of mixing and matching shots is something that was discussed today by an FDA advisory panel. It debated whether people would be well served by, say, pairing a J&J shot with a Moderna booster or a Pfizer one. The panel heard some groundbreaking data from the NIH on that exact question. The study showed that people who got an initial shot of Johnson & Johnson saw the biggest immune response when they got a Moderna booster shot. A Pfizer booster shot was second best, providing a big jump in antibody levels. But a second shot of Johnson & Johnson vaccine resulted in the lowest increase in antibody levels. Now, the panel did not vote today on whether or not to recommend mixing and matching vaccine and booster brands, but it seems like that might be on the horizon. When it comes to Johnson & Johnson boosters at large, the FDA panel today voted unanimously, 19-0, to recommend those boosters, essentially saying that they're a public health imperative since the immune response to the primary Johnson & Johnson vaccine is so low compared to Moderna and Pfizer. One panel member echoed the feelings of several of his colleagues when he said, quote, "I think this, frankly, was always a two-dose vaccine." That was a big factor in the group's decision to recommend the Johnson & Johnson booster for everyone over 18 who initially received the Johnson & Johnson shot. How do we make sense of this? Well, I know just who to ask. Joining us now is Dr. Celine Gounder, infectious disease specialist, epidemiologist at NYU Grossman School of Medicine and Bellevue Hospital, and former member of the Biden-Harris COVID-19 Advisory Council. Dr. Gounder, always good to see you. Thank you for being with us tonight.
It's great to be here, Ali.
Notwithstanding the fact that you actually had some involvement in Ebola all those years ago, it's a very interesting idea, this concept of actually giving people two doses. We were sort of told at the beginning, based on the information we had, that was not really, it was a non-starter. What do you make from the FDA's discussions today and what that'll likely lead to?
Yeah, I'll admit you kind of gave me flashbacks there. I spent 2 months in Guinea during the Ebola epidemic. With respect to our current pandemic and questions about mix and match of different vaccines, as well as needing additional doses, I think if you look at all the vaccines that we have, there is only one vaccine where we give a single dose. That is the yellow fever vaccine. Every other vaccine is given as 2, 3, 4 doses. And so many of us anticipated that you would really need to give multiple doses. With respect to mixing and matching, you know, one way to think about it is like a mugshot. And with one kind of vaccine, you get the face front on. With another kind of vaccine, you get the profile. And if you have both pictures, you're able to recognize that person that much better. And it's a little bit like that with these mixing and matching of vaccines, where your immune system is trained in different ways to recognize the virus.
So I guess the issue is, given that we're dealing with some vaccine hesitancy, I mean, I assume the population we're talking about, if they're offered a booster vaccine, will probably take it. But does it now cause people to pause for a second? If I got one Johnson & Johnson and now they're going to approve a second one as a booster, do I do that or do I try and wait till we figure out that I should just take a Pfizer or a Moderna shot?
I think big picture, you're still very well protected. And I've gotten this very same question from people who I know who've gotten a single Johnson & Johnson. Should I go ahead and get that J&J or should I wait? I think unless you're in a place where there's a lot of transmission, where you are in a high-risk occupation, you can afford to wait a couple more weeks here while we sort out which is the best second dose of vaccine. Is it J&J? Is it Moderna? Is it Pfizer?
What do you make of the implied criticism by some of the members of the panel who said this was supposed to be this should have been a two-dose shot in the first place?
Look, I think it was really noble to try to have a single dose vaccine. I think from a logistical perspective, it's a lot easier to vaccinate thousands, millions of people when it's a single dose. It's also much more equitable. You know, for a lot of people, taking time off work, getting childcare, transportation, all these things are significant barriers. And if you have to do that twice, you know, it becomes that much more of a barrier to getting vaccinated. So I think it was a noble effort. Unfortunately, it just didn't pan out that way.
Dr. Gounder, always good to see you. Thank you for putting some clarity to this. Dr. Celine Gounder is an infectious disease specialist and an epidemiologist at the NYU Grossman School of Medicine and Bellevue Hospital. Always good to see you. Still ahead, is the balance of power finally starting to shift in this country in a way that will benefit American workers? You're not going to want to miss this.